Hello everyone, welcome to Smart Catalyst. So today we are going to see the news analysis dated 29th January 2019. So there are some 6 topics for our today's analysis. The first one is about the National Agricultural Higher Education Project, which is launched by the ICAR, which is Indian Council for Agricultural Research. Second one is related to deadly superbug gene, which now makes its way into the islands of Arctic. So the third news item is related to electronic voting machines, which is in controversy that it shall be hacked. The fourth news item is related to India can't handle more big cats, that is India's forest ecosystem has reached the saturated level and so its carrying capacity for tiger conservation is a great concern. The fifth one is about the non-communicable diseases are the top killers in Southeast Asia, says WHO study. And the last article is about the prohibition of Binami Property Transaction Act. The first news item for our today's analysis is National Agricultural Higher Education Project. This item is taken from PIB. So the Indian Council for Agricultural Research, which is an autonomous organization under the Ministry of Agriculture, has recently launched the National Agricultural Higher Education Project. This project is to attract the talent and strengthen the higher agricultural education in the country. As we all know that we have an ambitious goal of doubling the farmers' income by 2022, we have to take some proactive measures like diversifying the agricultural activities. Apart from that, strengthening the agricultural education. The youngsters will be ready to do the agri-business and thereby export maximum agro products and thereby raising the incomes of the farmers. So this project was funded by the World Bank. So this should be noted for the prelims perspective as it is a potential question. And the Indian government is also sponsoring on a 50-50 basis. So in addition, the ICAR has also acknowledged a 4-year degree in agriculture, horticulture, fisheries and forestries should be declared as a professional degree. The Ministry of Agriculture has also planned to upgrade the already existing Rajendra Agriculture University to Dr. Rajendra Prasad Central Agricultural University. This move is to strengthen the government's effort to bring green revolution in the eastern India. As we all know that the limitation of green revolution, it is because of its disparity that has been created in the regions. So in order to overcome this disparity of green revolution in the regions, we have enhanced the green revolution in the eastern India through this Rajendra Prasad Central Agricultural University. So in this infographics, we have to note that the 3rd December of 2018 has been acknowledged as the National Agricultural Education Day by the Ministry of Agriculture and Farmers Welfare. So these are some of the initiatives undertaken by the Indian Council for Agricultural Research. So please note this in the PPT sent to you. As our Prime Minister Modi ji has mentioned that 21st century is the century of knowledge. So knowledge, science and education will have the power and strength to embrace the entire universe. So this knowledge, science and education should be implemented in the agricultural domain also in order to enhance the productivity as well as our aim of achieving the doubling of farmers' income by 2022. So in order to promote the participation of students in agricultural business, a scheme called Rural Entrepreneurship Awareness Development Yojana was implemented by the central government in order to have a practical experience of agriculture and entrepreneurship, especially among the youth community. So thereby it will promote the youth taking up the agri sector as one of the main sector and enhance its productivity and thereby making agricultural prosperous in our country. In addition to this, it should be noted that an MOU is signed between the Ministry of Agriculture and the Ministry of Skill Development to promote the skill development in the field of agriculture. So by integrating the Skill Development Ministry with the Ministry of Agriculture, the youth are trained to scientifically work in the agricultural domain and thereby making agriculture a technologically inclusive. The second news item is related to that EVMs may be under a cloud in India, but more than 20 nations use them. So this article has been taken from Hindu. So, political parties across the spectrum have expressed doubts about the electronic voting machines being manipulated. The history of electronic voting machines have started since 1989, which was started up by commissioning Electronic Voting Machine Commission. With this, the electronic voting machines have been used since 1999 general elections in India. So this was not the first time in the world to be used, because already some larger and older democracies like USA, Britain and other 20 countries are already using the voting machines. So following its success, India has also started using this electronic voting machines in 1999. Also, these EVMs has been regarded as the tamper-proof machines. So this can be justified by its 275 safety protocols which has been agreed upon, and there is no internet port, so no means to receive Wi-Fi, Bluetooth or wireless signal to be hacked, and it is also produced and processed under some sanitized conditions. The EVM chip which is used inside every electronic voting machine can be writable only once. So once written and encrypted, the chip cannot be read or overwritten. Besides this, some rigorous physical safeguards are in place during the transport and storage. So there is very least possibility of hacking the electronic voting machines. So as we have already seen that EVMs in India are not interconnected, no one can hack this. And if malfunctioning of one system cannot affect the others, because EVMs in India are standalone devices. Even though there is any malfunctioning detected, it can be rectified very soon. Besides this, before starting up of the election, every EVM's switch fidelity will be tested with voter verifiable paper audit trial before the political party agents. So these provisions will enable the Indian EVMs cannot be hacked or manipulated. As declared by the Karnataka High Court in 2004, EVMs are the pride of India. So its existence should be prevailed and its usage should be protected further. And one more fact for prelims is, even countries like Namibia is using the Indian manufactured EVMs. So this shows the fidelity and robustness of Indian manufactured EVMs. The third article is related to the deadly superbugs gene now makes its way to the islands of the Arctic. So this article has been taken from Mint. The term superbug here refers to the antibiotic resistant bacteria in a simple sense. A study shows that more than 7 lakh people die every year because of the overall antibiotic resistance globally. So this becomes a major concern for the scientific community to develop antibiotic resistant drugs. In this context, in 2012, in Delhi, a group of scientists have found out that a gene called BLANDM1. They said that this gene is responsible for the evolution of the superbugs. This makes bacteria more resistant to even the most powerful antibiotics. So if this goes on to continue, the evolving diseases caused by the bacteria shall not be treated because there is not availability of the drugs. The main reason that shall be attributed for this multi-drug resistant bacteria or superbug is because of the inefficient usage of the antibiotics. It may even be regarded as the abuse of antibiotics. So, this abuse of antibiotics that is spreading through the fecal matter of birds and other wildlife, human visitors have caused the evolution of the superbugs. Scientists have found almost 130 of antibiotic resistant genes, including one that confers the multi-drug resistance in tuberculosis, are widely spreading. The news is, this superbug is now has made its way to the islands of Arctic. So if its spread is not stopped immediately, there will be rising of deaths caused due to the superbugs. The bacteria are naturally developing resistance even in the remotest places such as Arctic is aggravating the problem. If this is not addressed, an extra 10 million people could die every year by 2050 because of this increasing resistance to antibiotics. So, deaths per year attributable to this antimicrobial resistance by 2050. Not only this, the financial cost to economies of drug resistance will add up to $100 trillion by 2050. So, because of this, the economic development as well as the demographic development of the countries will be under threat. And the next article is about India can't handle more big cats. So, this was taken from Indian Express. So, this news item says that the India's forest ecosystem has reached its saturation point in its carrying capacity. So, this news item conveys that the India's forest ecosystem has reached its saturation point in its carrying capacity. So, especially the carrying capacity of tigers have reached its end. So, it is need of the hour to take some measures to widen the area of the tiger conservation or to limit the tiger population. As of now, the conservation efforts aimed at increasing the tiger count in India via its major projects like Project Tiger, which have been initiated in 1973. So, now India must prepare for a new challenge, that is reaching the limits of its management capacity. India's current capacity to host tigers ranged from 2,500 to 3,000 tigers. So about 25 to 35% of tiger population of India is living outside the reserves. Because of this, the man and animal conflict is getting increased. So for prelims perspective, we have to note that some facts related to the conservation of the tiger population. As I have mentioned earlier that the Project Tiger was launched in 1973 by the National Tiger Conservation Authority under the Ministry of Environment and Forest Conservation. This National Tiger Conservation Authority is headed by the Prime Minister and its Vice Chairman is the Minister of Environment. As India has the maximum number of wild tigers in the world, it needs a foolproof plan to manage the growing number of the big cats. So as of now, the total number of wild tigers globally is around 3,800 plus in 2016. This is according to the report by World Wildlife Fund and Global Tiger Forum. So we shall see the reason for why India can't handle more tigers. The first reason is that habitat loss. The dwindling core forest area is a major concern and the major reason that can be attributed to the tigers coming out of reserves and shrinking of tiger corridors. So the next major reason that can be attributed to the threat of the tiger population is poaching and man-made conflicts. Because of the low availability of prey in some reserves, the tigers are coming out of their core areas in search of the prey and thereby getting involved into the man-made conflicts. So these challenges should be addressed as soon as possible because of our ambitious goal of doubling the tiger numbers by 2022 as made by the National Tiger Conservation Authority. So here we have to note that IUCN status of tiger is in endangered position. And this Project Tiger, which I have seen earlier, is 100% centrally sponsored scheme administered by the National Tiger Conservation Authority. The next news item for our analysis is related to the non-communicable diseases or reported to be the top killers in the Southeast Asia. So this was studied by World Health Organization. So this article has been taken from Hindu. A World Health Organization report has mentioned that the non-communicable diseases are the top killers in Southeast Asia. These non-communicable diseases mainly includes the cardiovascular diseases, chronic respiratory diseases, diabetes and cancer. The reasons attributable to this non-communicable diseases are mainly the behavioral aspects of the population. The report has mentioned that about 8.5 million lives per year are costed because of this non-communicable diseases. So it is the need of the hour to work upon the World Health Organization health goal of to contain the non-communicable diseases along with reducing mortality related to air pollution, climate change, global influenza pandemic. As I have said that the behavioral factors or the reasons for this non-communicable diseases can be regarded as tobacco usage, unhealthy diet, insufficient physical activity and harmful use of alcohol. So the major concern is that it disproportionately affects the poor and impoverished families. It also widens the global burden on the healthcare systems. Among the non-communicable diseases, the cardiovascular disease, which is the heart attack or myocardial infarction, is the reason for the more deaths in the Southeastern Asia. So how can we reduce this non-communicable diseases? So dietary habits should be regulated. Consuming fibers and whole grains can reduce the health risks for NCDs such as heart diseases. So eating fiber-rich foods reduces the incidence of coronary heart diseases. So the last article for our analysis is related to the prohibition of Binami Property Transaction Act. So this article has been taken from the Hindu. So in order to curb the money laundering activities through Binami property, the government of India in 1988 has enacted the Binomi Property Transaction Act. So after this, only in 2016, this Binomi Property Transaction Act has been amended. So we shall see some of the provisions mentioned in this amended act. As mentioned by the act, a Binomi transaction is an arrangement in which a property, either it can be a movable or immovable, is transferred to or held in the name of one person, which is the binamidar, but is actually the property's rights have been enjoyed by the another person, which is the beneficial owner. So under this act, the binamidar as well as the beneficiary are liable to the commissioning of act, and they may be prosecutable and may face rigorous imprisonment up to 7 years, besides up to 25% of the fair market value of the Binomi property. Not only this, if the person who furnished false information to the authorities under this prohibition of Binomi Property Transaction Act, they are also prosecutable and may be imprisoned up to 5 years, besides a fine amount of 10% of the fair market value. So the Binomi property may be attached and confiscated by the government through this Binomi Property Transaction Act. So these actions are in addition to actions under other laws such as the Income Tax Act. Thank you.